Hallelujah. Come on, why don't you rise up, church? It's worship on Wednesday. Oh, at Living Faith Family Worship Church. We thank you, Lord. Oh, we ask you, Father, to just open up the sky tonight. Yeah, yeah, pour out your blessing, Father. Come on, let's sing it. Father, I just want to be where you are. My life is filled with everything but you. Yeah. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Gonna see your kingdom come. Hey. Tell me, can you hear the sound of desperation? A prayer on the lips of every nation. Up the sky,
open up the sky.
Well, let's sing again. Father, Lord, Father, I just want to be where you are. Yes, Lord, my life is filled with everything but you. Yeah, yeah. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Let the fire of heaven fall on. Sing that again. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Yeah, Lord. Let the fire of heaven fall on me. Can you feel my passion? Can you see my hunger? Do you know how long? Take away this darkness. Come break this heart of stone. Hear our cry. Open up the sky. Oh. Open up the sky. Open up the sky.
Open up the sky.
Yeah, yeah. Open up the sky. Open up the sky. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Oh, we bless you tonight, Father God. Your worship tonight, Father. You're glorified, Jesus. We thank you, Father God. Yeah, yeah. So, Lord, we bless your mighty name. Come on with a loud shout. Oh, give a shout to the Lord tonight. Come on, church. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Let the fire of heaven fall on me. Come on, sing that again. Lord, I really want to see your glory. your glory. Let the fire of heaven fall on me. Come on, let's see it again. Lord, I really want to see your glory. Lord, I really want to see your glory, Lord. Let the fire of heaven fall on me. Can you feel my passion? Can you see my hunger? Do you know how long? Take away this darkness.
Come break this
heart of stone. Hear our cry. Open up the sky. Yes. Open up the sky. Yes, Father. Open up the sky.
Open up the sky.
Yes. Oh, give the Lord a shout of glory. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord, for your greatness. Oh, we bless you. Yeah. Here I am before you, falling in love, seeking your truth, knowing that your perfect grace has brought me to this place. Because of you, I freely live. My life to you, oh God, I give. So I stand before you, God. I lift my voice, 'cause you set me free. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops, I proclaim that I am yours, I am yours. All the good you've done for me, I lift up my hands for all to see. You're the only one to share another. So I kneel before you, God. I lift my hands, 'cause you set me free. Come on, sing it. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. Oh, and all that I am, I bring to your the one, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. And here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours, yes, I am yours. And all that I am, I place my we can shout from the rooftops. Oh, we can praise you, mighty God, without reservations, Lord God. Hallelujah. We can come before your holy throne and just worship your holy name, Father. Oh, yeah, yeah. I am yours. I am yours. Come on and sing. Here I am, I stand, Lord. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one, the Son, the everlasting God. Yes, the everlasting God. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one, the Son, the everlasting God. Shout out your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. And all that I am, I place into your loving hands. And I am yours. Yes. I am yours. So shout out your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. And all that I am, I place into your loving hand, and I am yours.
Declaration together tonight that we are the Lord's. And just lift your hands and surrender now to Him. Father, we surrender our evening to You, and we know You've brought us to this house, Lord, to honor You, Lord, to serve You, and to give to You. Father, I pray that as we continue the teaching of the book of Malachi, Lord, You are instructing us how to live in the righteousness of the Lord. And as we have surrendered our lives through praise and through worship, through our hearts lifted, our hands lifted, Lord, we know that when we come together in faith, when there's two or three gathered in Your name, You are with us. So we welcome the presence of the Holy Spirit tonight in our service for those that are viewing around the world. We welcome the presence of the Holy Spirit, who is the administrator of the church. He's the leader of this body. And He is welcome to lead. So Holy Spirit, have Your way. Hallelujah and hallelujah. To God be the glory, church. Amen. I want you to do your best to shake some people's hands right now, just around you. Hug on some people, love on some people. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
So I shout out your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am yours. Yeah. I am yours. And all that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours. So I shout out your name from the rooftops. I
Lord, come on, give the Lord a great hand clap of honor. We praise you, Jesus, and we love you, Lord. Amen. Why don't you say it? I love you, Lord.
I love you,
Lord. I praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. High five your neighbor. You may be seated in the house this evening. The praise team can also be seated among the congregation. We're just so happy to be in the house of the Lord. Somebody said to me the other day, Pastor, you always say that. You say it on the radio, you say it at church, and well, how else is there to live but happy? Amen. How would you like for me to say, well, it's a burden to be in the house of the Lord today? No, you don't want to hear that, right? You want to hear, you know, it's blessed to be in the house. David even said, I'd rather be at the front door. Come on, out the door. I'd rather be the mat. Come on. I forsake not the assembly of God. So I really look forward. You know, yesterday I thought it was Wednesday. I really did. I was gearing up and I was getting my posts ready for Facebook and everything. And Kim's like, you know, because she's my spell check. Before I post it, I give it to my wife. And she does all my spell checks. And she says, wait a minute, today's Tuesday. I said, Tuesday? She says, yes, Tuesday, not Wednesday. And I said, well, praise the Lord. I'm just excited about church. Amen. I'm just excited about church. And so it's a blessing. It's a blessing. We're so honored to have Amber here in the front row. She's on our splash zone. Praise the Lord. I love how Amber, Ruby, and Claire come in their scrubs to church. Amen. I mean, from work to worship. Come on. From work to worship. Amen. Amen. And I feel good having nurses in the house. Amen. Hallelujah. What a blessing. What a blessing. And so Amber is the fruit of an invitation of these individuals here in the front row. And she came to our women's outreach, Abigail's ministry. And out of that fruit, she has committed herself to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And so it's a blessing. You know, she's living in Dilly, so we're praying about all that. But, you know, no, it's good. We're honored to have Mr. Benny Flores here with us tonight. Give him a great hand clap. Amen. I believe it was Father's Day he came, or maybe the Sunday after Father's Day, and he was here, and he really enjoyed service, and the Lord really ministered unto him, and I'm really seeing a glow in him right now. The anointing is all over him right now, and it's just a blessing, amen. And to see people and families just come to the house of God. I had one individual, you know, driving yesterday, and they stopped by and somebody waved them down and asked them for something and then asked them, you know, invite me to church. I said, well, you're inviting everybody else to church. Why don't you invite me to church? You know, and that's a great thing where people want to be invited, come on, to the house of worship. And, you know, that later ended in, you know, we are a walking testimony. We are a walking Bible that people see every day. And if we're not inviting people to Jesus, you know, to see him in his word and to come and fellowship in the word corporately in the body of Christ at church, then I just don't want to exist in life. I think Brother Ferrier said that at one of our men's. I just don't want to exist in life. I want to do something with the life God gave me. Amen. And our testimony in itself speaks far more than our own words, right? I heard a man of God say this one day, you know, when you're preaching, you know, just live your life and talk if needed. Praise the Lord, you know, but just live your life and let people see the blessing of the Lord upon you. It was such a blessing to go to a house today. My father accompanied me and we went to the Aguilar home right here down Johnston Street, and we're praying for Mr. Aguilar and we're believing God for supernatural life. Now the doctors have given him just days to live, and you know, when we walk into a situation like that, Lewis, you know, because you've been there many times with us, you know, we can't claim death or speak, you know, Lord, take him already, he's in pain. We're there to speak life. God is the receiver of life, not us. So we're there to preach and proclaim life. And it was such a blessing. We walked in and the ladies were there and they were greeting us, and we had church even before we stepped into the room. And right, Dad, and we were having church and just praying and praying. And then I said, can he hear? Or my dad said, can he hear? No, he hasn't heard. He can't see, he can't hear, he can't even talk. He hasn't eaten nothing for 4 days. It was a very bad situation. Come on, church, come on. Very bad situation. We walked into that bedroom and he was there lying there, and we spoke the authority of the name of Jesus. Dad began to prophesy and proclaim Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. God is with me. God is with you, Mr. Aguilar. He began to preach. I began to pray. Praise the Lord. Come on. When you got a prayer warrior and a preacher hooked together, you're going to have the power of God. Oh, come on, somebody. Didn't they say that he couldn't speak? They said he hadn't spoken for 4 or 5 days because he hasn't eaten anything. He got so weak. And after that prayer, and we anointed it from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. And when we said amen and amen, what come out of his spirit, Dad? Amen. I mean, that's what you heard. Praise the Lord. Come on, somebody. There was a wave in that place. There was a wave of glory in that place. Even Belinda Rodriguez and the other sister from Dallas and Mama was there. And when he yelled out, amen, you know, that Hispanic accent, amen, you know. I mean, everybody just stood back like, hallelujah. I tell you what, there were angels in that room right there. I felt the angelic presence like no other, you know. And whether people see it, feel it, I know what we carry. Hallelujah. And so we speak healing and life to him. How many of y'all know them, that family? Y'all know them in that family? Amen. Well, we're just continuing to pray and believe, you know, God's supernatural will be done in his life. And this is how we pray when we go to situations like that. Father, we commit our brother and we commit our trust to you. Amen. You see, we're not there claiming death or anything. We're there claiming we put our trust in you. And you know, that taught me something today, because in everything we are to trust. Amen? Amen. I want us to go to Malachi chapter 2 tonight. I'm going to have it on the screen for you, but I really, really want you to do your best during these teachings to either bring a Bible, or maybe you have your Bible on your iPad or your iPhone or smartphone. That's fine. If you need a Bible, you know, we can do our very best to help you with that. Do your very best, especially during these Bible times that we are really dissecting the Word of God, because I want you to see it for yourself. Amen. I want the Bible that I read be the Bible that's on your lap right now. Amen. It's not a Mark Linnaeus version. Come on, somebody. It is the God version. Hallelujah. And that's the greatest version there is. Now, we've learned from our previous messages, and now you've known this, that all Scripture is inspired by God. Amen. All Scripture. So from the leather cover to the leather cover on the back. All Scripture is inspired by God. God wouldn't have 66 books written. He wouldn't have all these authors be inspired by the Holy Spirit to put all this down if we were to leave some of it out. He wants it all for us. Amen. If you were asked, you want all the blessing or half the blessing? How many of you would say, I just want half the blessing? No, we would say we want what? All the blessing. Amen. And so the Bible is about God's supernatural voice talking to you and me. And here in Malachi chapter 2, that word trust is really what is being spoken right now. I want you to say it with me, trust.
Trust.
You know, I was doing some, believe it or not, I was doing a little bit of walking last night. I don't know what led me to do that. I felt just to walk a little bit, and I began to ask the Lord about trust and trust and trust, Dad. I didn't know about the situation we were going to be called upon today, but the Lord has already. I love when God already prepares you before the matter. Amen.
Amen.
He prepares you before you walk through. You know, it's just like the Bible when it says, "They though I walk through the valley." Well, before you walk through the valley, He's already telling you, "I'm going to provide for you." He's already telling you, I'm going to make you still and know that I'm going to bless you. You see, God prepares you always. And so as I was walking yesterday, Lewis, and praying, that word trust has kept on ringing in my spirit. And you know me, I like to teach the word of God. And so me, I like to have visuals and I like to see things. So I began to spell the word trust, T-R-U-S-T. Is that correct? T-R-U-S-T. My wife's with Tiffany, so she's not my spell check tonight. But Mama, you be my spell check. T-R-U-S-T. And I was thinking about marriages. And I was thinking about, you know, Malachi chapter 2. And I was thinking about, you know, how you know, the people here, the children of Israel, really disgraced God by doing treachery, breaking their faith, their covenant with God. And really what happened is they lost their trust among each other. And they lost their trust among God. Now, that's a very scary place to be. Very scary place to be when you just start living careless and have no trust in the people around you and have no trust in God. Because then you feel that everyone is out to get you. Huh? Now you feel like you're just back behind a wall and everyone is against you. And you don't have nowhere else to go. You know, and so when you lose that trust, well, it really, you know, affects a person. So I was thinking, Griselda, and happy birthday, Griselda. Give her a great hand clap. Amen. I told her, you turned 29. She corrected me, 21. I said, all right. I began to see the word trust, T-R-U-S-T. And I said, well, in a marriage, you got to be what? Teachable. I think in every person's life, and I know we're talking to people that are married here, and maybe people that have been divorced, maybe people that have never even had a marriage yet, or maybe people that are even just living together. I know we have all kinds of individuals. But in the midst of that, growing with each other, family, friends, we have to be teachable. Amen? And then TR, okay? Well, What else do we have to have? And these are just very practical things that I felt the Lord was showing me. We have to be, you know, reachable. Come on, somebody. Amen. I can't be so spiritually minded. I'm no earthly good. Come on. I gotta be reachable. You know, when my sons talk to me, I don't talk to them like, well, thou sayeth the Lordeth of the hosteth. You know, I talk to them like, boy, this is what God said. You better shape up or I'm going to ship you out. You know, No. I mean, you got to be reachable. If they call me, I'm there. You know, if they need prayer, I'm there. Praise the Lord. If they need words of encouragement, I'm there. And if they need money, I lead them to mommy. Hallelujah. You know, I mean, just I'm reachable. T-R-U. Well, in a marriage, you got to be united, right? You got to be together. You can't. How can the blind lead the blind? You got to be united. You got to be together. U S T-R-U-S-S. You gotta be sensitive. Uh-oh, come on, man. We gotta be sensitive. You know, sometimes I walk into the house and Kim's just crying. I said, why are you crying? And I give her a box of tissue, a roll of toilet paper, and I say, here you go. You know, I just want a hug. And I was like, well, why are you crying? I don't know. And I was like, oh my goodness. And then we both start crying, you know. And we got to be sensitive, you know. Sometimes if a mistake happens in a marriage or a mistake happens with our family or our children, we can't always just blow up, right? We got to be sensitive to some areas and be slow to, you know, to be angry. Just be sensitive to those areas. So that's S. What's the next word? T. Oh, that's good. Let me see here. T. What did the Lord tell me last night about that last word, T? Yeah. Let me see here. T. That's right. He told me, y'all need to say it. So what do you think y'all ought to have right there with that word T? Trust. All right, I like that. That's good. What else? What other word that's practical in a marriage? You ought to be also what? Teachable. Together. I like that. Teachable. That's good. What else? What else? What else? What else? Tied together. That's good. All right. I know some of those Mexicans waiting. Y'all got that lasso, you know. Woo, tied together. Yeah, Ruby knows about lasso because her hubby's always lassoing. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let me see here. Let me see here. Well, the word that he gave me was the word in Malachi chapter 2 where it talks about we can't be treachery. Treachery. What do you mean, Pastor? We should not break our covenant. We should not break our faith. We should not lose our heart with the one that God has given to us. Pastor, my situation is rotten right now. You don't know my situation. Well, are you trusting in him? Are you trusting in her? Are you trusting in them? Are you gonna trust in the Lord? That's the question we have to come to in our life. Oh, but Pastor, you've never been through this. You've never walked the walk I live. You don't have a past like, praise God, I don't. Amen. Somebody told me that. I said, praise God, I don't. Amen. Praise God, God saved me from some of that mess you came from. I don't know why you went through that. I don't know why sometimes bad things happen even to good people. But if you keep on saying all that, you're going to continue to live in that mess. And that mess won't even become a message. It will become a bigger mess. Come on. So I tell that person, clean up your room. Come on. Dust your knees off. Get up and go. Hallelujah. So don't look at me. Don't look at anybody else. Look at your, you see, and that was the issue here with these individuals here in verse number 10. Have we not one father? Someone say, I have one father. And he's Abba. He's our father. If we are in Christ, amen, he is our hope and he is our glory, then God is our Father. Amen. Have we not all one Father? Has not one God created us? Why do we deal treacherously? Why do we lose trust, break the faith, break the covenant? And an abomination has been committed in Israel. Now, when we see the word Israel, I want you to see the word people. So in your Bible, you can write that, people. He says here, he says, why do you deal treacherously with one another? With who? One another. With who? One another. Why do you break your commitment among the union God blessed you with? Your covenant. Your relationships. Why do you deal with it this way? He says it is an abomination. It is completely against God's ways. It is an abomination and has been committed in Israel. It has been committed in the people. He's not singling anybody out right now. He's talking to the people. He is saying, well, you did it and you did it. You're a sore thumb and you're a bad thumb. No, he's not spotlighting individuals or individual families. He's talking to the people and he's telling the people, why have you lost your trust in me? Why have you dealt treacherously? You are creating an abomination against me. The people have committed this, and in Jerusalem. Now he's talking about the city. Did you know when there's corruption in our people, there will be corruption in our city? Did you know when there's corruption in our politics and policies, there'll be corruption in the workforce, in our communities? Did you know when there's corruption in the Senate or the government, wherever there is corruption, there is the fruit of foul practice. So he's launching this out to the people, Israel, and now he's talking to them and he's saying, did you know that your decisions are not just affecting people, but you're affecting the entire nation? Come on, somebody. You're affecting everything and everyone. Makes it pretty plain here. And then he says, for Judah has profaned the Lord's holy institution, which he loves. Now he's making it very personal. Now I believe Malachi is pointing to those men and to those families who are dealing treachery with the Lord. He's looking at them eye to eye. And he's telling them, what you have done is an abomination to God. Regardless of how they felt, regardless of how their feelings were, because I know, listen, church, this subject on marriage, divorce, remarriage is a very sensitive and a very touchy subject. That's why most pastors, most leaders do a curve around it. Because they don't want to deal with the repercussions of it. They don't want to deal with the questions of it. Because there's a lot of questions about it. But did you know that God ultimately has his divine plan for marriage? We read this in Genesis, and it was so powerful. Brother Freddie, hit you like a ton of bricks. You already knew it before it even came out. I saw you already bubbling up. And you told Lottie already, boom, 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 before it came out of this vessel right here. Wasn't that the truth? I felt it come out of you, even before it came out. In the beginning, God created what? Human. He created his man. And in the man was woman. So in one being, there was two. There was man and woman. That's why the Bible says he created them. He blessed them. And then later on the chapter, he says, I see that it's not good for man to be alone. So therefore, let me make him a helpmeet compatible to him. And God had a sense of humor. He brought some animals to him, seeing if he'd like that partner. And Adam wasn't fulfilled with animals. He wasn't fulfilled with anything else because it wasn't like him. Animals weren't created in the image of God. Adam was the only one created in the image of God. And so a compatible partner would be another one created in the image of God. And so nothing was attractive to him. So God said, you know what? Let me lay you down. I'm going to put you to rest. I'm going to make you sleep real good right now. And the Bible says that he opened him up and took out woman from the man, right? So the woman was already in the man. How many of you for the very first time have ever heard that before? Amen. It's a teaching church, and we need to know that. Amen. Sometimes we miss it, you know, or sometimes we're too prideful to even admit it. But we're a teaching church, so we need to understand in the beginning when God created us, he created everything in us. We are the likeness of God. He created everything we ever need in us. Come on. That's why the body heals itself. That's why a wound closes. Come on. Yeah, sometimes we put a little Neosporin, it helps it and all that good stuff. But did you know you've been created to heal yourself? Huh? So he cut man, right? And he took the rib out of man and made woman, right? Adam now wakes up and sees this woman because she was taken out of the womb of man. And he says, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. We notice that that was a union committed to God. And God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. And in the new covenant, God sent Jesus, who is the second Adam. He sent Jesus, came to through a Virgin Mary, came into this earth, and everything was in Jesus. What's everything? Jesus, the Son, God the Father, and the church operating by the Holy Spirit. Everything was in Christ. And Jesus lived 33 and a half years preaching, teaching, rebuking, and helping, and giving clarity to the scripture, even being tested by the Pharisees, but yet brought them into their rightful place. You know, he was all of that. And then at the age of 33, he's crucified on a tree, right? He says, Father, Father, I commit my spirit into your hands. And the Bible says he gave up the ghost, or he breathed his last breath. In the midst of all that, because it was that specific night, that they didn't want to break his legs. And to fulfill the scripture, the Bible even says, no broken bones shall be on the Messiah Jesus. But the other ones, they broke their legs. And so the attendant, or the Roman soldier, got that spear and he pierced Jesus just to make sure he was dead. It's just like the devil, always taking another shot. Come on. Huh? He's not just going to hit you. He's going to make sure you're down. Come on, somebody. He's not just going to come after you. He's going to want to come after all your children, too. Come on. He's going to want to make sure you're down and everything else that you're trying to do is down. He's going to distract you, deceive you, and if you let him, he'll then demolish you. It's just like the enemy trying to take a cheap shot at the family. Well, that was, in that case, the Roman soldier, he may not have even known it, but everything is ordained by God. God knows the beginning from the end from the beginning. He knew that the church, the Spirit of the living God, had to come out of Jesus. Come on. And so that Roman soldier, thinking, I'm just going to make sure he's dead, stabbed his rib. And I don't think he counted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 right here is where I need to aim. No, he just, out of frustration, wanting to get home, he's late for dinner. Come on, somebody, huh? It's just like all of us. When it's 5 o'clock, we're time watchers. I mean, it's 4:59, 59, 59. Most of us already have our computer closed, Yeti in our hand. I mean, we're ready to go. Huh? Come on. Well, this Roman soldier was the same way. He was ready to go. And so he wasn't aiming properly. He just poked Jesus. And he poked him between the 7th, which means completion, and the 8th rib, which means new beginnings. And so when he poked the rib open, blood and water came out, the scripture says in Mark. And for the only thing we have in our life that says we're alive is what? Blood and water. You can't live without blood. Come on. And you can't live without what? Water. And so in order for this church to be living, not living faith, but the church of the living God, come on, we have to be covered in the blood of Christ, and we have to be in operation by the flowing of the Holy Spirit, because he is the flowing of the rivers of living water. Hallelujah. The church came out of Christ. What the enemy thought he was trying to take a cheap shot, God said, nope, you just loosed, hallelujah, whoo, the church into the earth. That's powerful. That's fresh food out the oven. Come on, somebody. Esme pulled me aside. I've been reading all this. I don't get what Pastor Mark. How you get all that? Keep reading, Esme. God's going to show you. Just keep reading. those that are hungry and those that are thirsty shall be filled. Come on. We will never get tired of, I'll be 85 years old still preaching. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Yeah, because we'll never get tired of the Word of God. If we become complacent, Lewis, it's because we become comfortable and we've lost our trust. We become to give carelessly. We don't just think about church anymore. We don't think about blessing people anymore. We don't think about helping people. We don't think about preaching the gospel anymore because we become comfortable. This chair has become comfortable for me. I'm fine the way I am. Well, that's not the way God wants you. God wants you a living, breathing, marching machine. Amen. For His glory. He says, why have you dealt with me treacherously? Why have you given up your faith? Why, in other words, why have you committed adultery? That's what he's saying. Why have you traded me for an image, lowercase g, God? Why have you given me up for something like that? This is what God says. He's making it very personal, but he's talking to Judah. That's the person now. He first talked to the people. It's all of us. And now he's telling us, because of the people's mistakes and issues, the whole city and nation is going to take it. And now he steps in and he begins to talk to you personally. And he says in verse number 11, for Judah has profaned the Lord's holy what is it? Holy. It's just not an institution. You know, today in our world today, because of what we see and because of what we hear, did you know that divorce in the church is higher than the divorce in anything else? People just divorce because they don't like an issue, or they get too caught up on something, and they just throw in the towel and they just give up and they just say, well, I just get a divorce. I just get a certificate. I mean, Moses said it. I guess I can do it. And people use that as a license to think that they are free from adultery. It's a very strong words, church. But if you deal with this holy institution with treachery, broken faith, we have committed adultery. We have divorced our Father, our love, our blessing, our life. And he says it here. He says, he has married the daughter of a foreign God. May the Lord cut all from the tents of Jacob. What is he saying? No more offspring from you. I'm cutting that marriage bed, that tent. I'm cutting it. I don't want anything from you anymore. That's what he's saying. Why did God tell Adam and tell Eve, I bless you and I want you to be fruitful and multiply? Let me answer that right now, which is in the verses coming up. He says, may the Lord cut off from the tents of Jacob the man who does this, being awake. I want you to see that word, awake and aware. Yet who brings an offering to the Lord of hosts. They've already committed adultery, and now they want the Lord to bless their seed. When God just said, I just cut you off. And this is the second thing. The first thing was they went to foreign gods. They committed adultery. The second thing you do, you cover the altar with tears, weeping and crying, as if my emotion, your tears are going to change or move God. So he does not regard, the Bible says, the offering anymore, nor receive it with goodwill from your hands. It could be the best seed ever. But if you are an adulterer and have committed that crime between the covenant of the institution of God, God does not want your offering. That's what he's saying, Malachi, to these people who speak now to a nation or a community who now is speaking personally. Because see, in these teachings, and let me say this to just kind of help us out, we should not feel condemned at all. If there is a condemnation that you are feeling right now, the Bible says for those that are in Christ, Romans 8:1, there is no condemnation. So if there is a sense or a feeling of condemnation, I'm just not liking what I'm hearing. It's not sitting right. This pastor is wrong. If you are feeling condemned, it is because you, sir, you, ma'am, are not in Christ. But if you are feeling convicted, oh man, I've been living in sin. Oh man, why didn't my previous pastor tell me this? I wouldn't have gone through all of this mess that I went through if they would have told me. Well, let me help you. It wasn't his job to tell you. It is your job to learn. It is your job to learn. It's great to come to the house. It's great to be fed. But you only go out to eat probably a couple of times, huh? A week, if that. Some go once. Some don't even come to church. I mean, go out to eat. But how many of you eat every day? Some of you get home at 5 o'clock and you are sitting there chugging your ice bucket and waiting for someone to fill it up. Come on, somebody. You're waiting for that food. You need that food, huh? I wake him in the morning, I start licking my lips. I mean, I'm ready. Huh? Yeah, because we eat every day. Our spirit is the same. Well, pastor's not calling you every day. Well, the pastor's not checking on you every day. I mean, he don't have to. And he shouldn't. If he has to, then it's because then there's still a little bit of pamper going on. And the pastor's just having to clean a little bit. And then when the complaining comes, put that mamon in their mouth. Huh? They get all feisty. We were at the NICU or with the baby, and Mama Kim was holding Evan, and all you hear, because they're at a bunch of babies, and it's like clockwork. I mean, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon and 40 babies are. And I'm like, what's going on? The nurse is like, yep, they're hungry. So all the nurses go and they start putting that milk in their, you know, in their mouth or that bottle. Or the mamas come and they handle it all together, you know. And it's like, wow, I mean, who opened up the floodgates? I mean, who's where all these women come from? It's like they feel it. My baby's hungry, you know, and they start headed that way. Well, it's just like babies. They have to eat and sure, they're going to be fed. But when we grow in God, we fix dinner ourselves. Come on. Huh? My wife was gone. I had nobody to feed me. My son was at the house alone. I ain't gonna feed him. So there's a special in town, $2.50 for a burger. I want two, please. I put him down, and before I get my water out, he's already on the second burger. And I said, Mark! So praise God for Sister Ana Ramon and the Holy Ghost chicken salad she brought me last night at 10 o'clock, hallelujah, or Javier brought it to me. I pulled out that chicken salad and I had me a sandwich to go. Come on. Amen. But I had to feed myself, right? Yes, yes. So it's great And I encourage, as we always come to the house of God, but we ought to learn from God's word and his rhema and revelation every day. Hallelujah. Even if it's just one scripture, one chapter. Because before you know it, listen, when you were a baby, you drank a little bit of ounces, right? And then you start growing. Come on. And then you want rice in that titi good, right? Come on. And then you want solid food. Come on, right? And then you want the real good. So see, you start growing. And you start growing. These individuals were dealing with their covenant carelessly. They didn't care and they didn't trust anymore. And they were sinning in the eyes of God. And you say, well, how? How? Well, let's read. Let's keep on reading. Yet you say in verse 14, for what reason? Remember, God's not accepting their offering anymore because they've committed adultery. And so he says, they're saying, why don't you accept our seed? Why don't you accept our offering? Because the Lord has been witness. Witness of what? Of your marriage. Now, I love watching marriages and I love doing marriages. That's a wonderful thing. And we talk beforehand and we pray over them and make sure that this is what they want to commit for, because it's life. It's a one deal thing. It's not a tryout. Come on, somebody. It's not, let me just try it out and let me see if I like it. If I not, I'll just leave. You know, no, it's a life till death do you what? Part, for better or for what? Worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness or in health. What is God saying? Deal with your problems. Come on, somebody. Deal with your issues. Come on. Don't run out. He's saying don't be a wimp about it and just run out. That's what he's saying. This is tough love, guys. And I know I'm talking to a variety of people in here, but I'm talking to the world too, and they need to understand this. And I'm almost done with this small portion. I still got more to come. Because God is, I was at mom's house today, you know, and man, it came pouring out. Mom, you heard that. And it came pouring out of the radio. The devil tried to stop the radio this morning, Tommy, taking off power here and there. No, devil, we're calling in generators that will just come on. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father God. We call it done. Because the Lord has been the witness. Now, most marriages, they have witnesses, you know. Like, who's your best man? Who's your matron of honor? Who's going to be standing? I mean, some of us have 15 people on one side and 25 on the other side. And then sometimes you walk into, you know, you walk into the church and, you know, the groom's side is on this side and the woman's side is on this side. And you always know where the groom's side, because there's rarely anybody over there. But on the women's side, there's the whole plethora of people, you know, praise the Lord. And you have all these witnesses. And sometimes a marriage is just focused on these witnesses and these people. But really, the holy institution of God is not between them and you. It's between you and the Lord. Come on. That's why he is so serious about this covenant. This covenant. It's a contract that should not be breached, broken at all. God's way of marriage is that we are married to the person our entire life. That's God's way. That's God's way. Now, let me just show you briefly what the Pharisees said about God's way. Turn to Matthew chapter 19 in my closing. Matthew chapter 19 in my closing. For the record of the teaching, so that you can also hear it out of the lips of Jesus. Okay? Now, from the lips of Malachi to the lips of Jesus. Now, let me just see a show of hands. Who's learning right now? Anybody learning? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who appreciates this teaching? Amen. I see that one hand. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Now it came to pass, verse 1, when Jesus had finished these sayings, that he had finished these sayings, and he then departed to Galilee, from Galilee, and came to the region of Judea beyond the Jordan, and a great multitude followed him, and he healed them there. The Pharisees also came to him. Wow, they were also following Christ. The Pharisees also came to him. But they were what? Testing him. I remember the first years of ministry, people would sit in church and they'd just be testing the preacher. I'd say a scripture. God forgive them. Have mercy on their soul. And the Pharisees came to him, testing him, saying to him, it is lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? And he answered and said to them, haven't you done your homework? You go to church. You're a Pharisee. Haven't you not read that he who made them at the what? Who was he talking about? Genesis, the creation. He was talking about Adam and Eve. He said, don't you remember who made them at the beginning, made male and female, and said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then, they are no longer two, but they are one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man, come on, that's earthly rule, earthly struggle, earthly situation, separate them. Amen. And they said to him, these are the Pharisees, why then? Because they thought they got him. They thought, ha, we're smarter than Jesus. Then they said to him, why then did Moses command to give a certificate of divorce and put her away? Mm-mm. Do you think Jesus was stuttering at this time? Do you think he was, you know, in the hot seat? Oh my goodness, they got me now. What am I gonna say? Holy Spirit, speak through me, please. No. Jesus knew exactly what to say. And he said, Moses, directing it to the man, because of their treachery, their hardness, their broken faith. Come on. Their hardened hearts. Moses didn't want to deal with the people anymore. Didn't want to deal with them anymore. All their emotions, all their ups and downs, all their likenesses and their dislikes, all their strengths and all their weaknesses, all their compatibilism, everything. They weren't mixing together, and Moses didn't want to deal with it. And so, you know what? God made it easy for Moses and said, fine. Because of their hardened hearts, let them write a certificate of separation and divorce. Moses, because of the hardness of their hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so. Meaning, that is not God's way. That's Moses' way. And I say to you, this is Jesus now speaking. I love it. Whoever divorces his wife except from sexual immorality, fornication, you commit adultery, you commit that kind of sin, you go into someone else's bedchambers and you commit a sin with someone that's not yours. And I say to you, he was talking to the Pharisee to his disciples, to everyone that was listening. Whoever divorces his wife except from sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. He just answered the question when they said, is it lawful just to divorce just because we had a fight? We had an issue. We had a disagreement. And I don't like her now. I have that saying always, well, I love them, but I'm just not in love with them. Marriage is not about in love. Marriage is about your holy institution between God and the covenant you have with him. That's what marriage is. And that's the issue that's served in our world today, because Hollywood says one thing and the holy book says another thing. And so many people, because they're visual people, they see it so much on television. We have wimpy families that are on showcases getting a reality, and they're teaching people and teaching our children, this is the way real life is. It is not the real life. It's the real life that is bound for hell. But the real life that has taken this trust, this covenant, this marriage vow seriously to God, then does not deal treacherously. And Jesus Christ said it. Someone, you know, called me the other day, Tommy, and said, I can't believe you're teaching like this. I can't. Listen, I told them, I can't believe your church is letting you. I said, we're not a man-run church. Amen. That's right. I said, there's no board that's going to tell this pastor how to talk to the people. There is a holy board, and his name is God the Father, Jesus the Son, the Holy Ghost, and the vision that God has given Pastor Mark and Pastor Kim. And I told that person, and if anybody has a problem with that, go see my father, who is the president of this board. Come on, somebody. Well, I just won't ever be in that church. Okay, then just continue where you are, and I'll pray for you. That's all I could do. I can't believe. Well, you're going to have to believe one day the truth, because it's the truth that will set you completely free of the bondage of sin. Pastor, it's going to hurt. Pastor, it's going to take away from me if it's going to bless you if you deal with God righteously and not treacherously. And that's why this whole entire book of Malachi is bringing back the reverence of God, the fear of God. I fear the Lord. And that's why it comes out as loving as it can to help people. Somebody asked me, what do you want in the church? Change. That's what I want in the church. Sometimes I wish I could shake someone into their change, but I can't. Because it'll be then like, well, Moses said this. Who are you going to believe? We're going to believe God's word. And from the very beginning, God said, it's holy. Why is it holy? Because it's between you and God. That's why it's holy. I tell my wife, it's not between our fights, our bickers, our disagreements, or our praises, or our love, or our goods, our bads. It's between and God. And so if a couple or a relationship fears God, and they're going to do all that they can to honor him. Amen. Why did Jesus say only it is okay with God if your spouse commits fornication, adultery? Then it's okay for you to go and cleave yourself and make new covenant. Why did only God use that term? Because the children of Israel, they gave up God for a foreign God. They said, God, I don't trust you no more. I don't need you no more. She's prettier. She gives me more. She has more to offer. So I trade my blessings for her curses. I trade heaven for hell. And God doesn't want you to do that. He doesn't want us to trade. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but yet lose his soul? I fear God. Don't fear the man that can touch or kill your outer. Fear the one who can destroy your soul. You know, covenant was broken at the very beginning. It was broken. What do you mean, Pastor? Divorce was in the garden? Yes. The lying devil, who still exists today, who is defeated to the believers, he whispers and he says, did God say? He questions the word of God. And if you're not a studier, come on, if you're not a student of the word of God, then you'll question when the enemy talks to you. And he said, did God say you would surely die if you eat of that fruit? Because Eve said, we can have whatever we want, but we can't touch that fruit. Because then God said, we'd die. Now we know through the books of Genesis and throughout, Adam and Eve, they didn't die. They didn't. Actually, they lived hundreds of years. But you know what happened? Whew. They cut themselves spiritually off of God. God no longer was walking with Adam in the cool of the day. What happened? God said, out of the garden. And he put cherubims, angels on the corners. And he said, no one again in this garden. Because they dealt with me treacherously. They broke my covenant. They committed adultery. And God said, no more. Everything I... Now, Adam, you're going to sweat from your brow. Now, Eve, you're going to have pain. Come on. When they had it all for them. So if we give in to the lie of the enemy and commit adultery spiritually, we're dealing treacherously, broken faith with the Lord. When the Lord is preparing a bride, come on, without spot and without wrinkle. He's preparing a bride for the new Jerusalem. He's preparing a bride that knows how to live righteously in the fear of God. Lift your hands. I pray now, Lord, that you would continue to speak to us through the message. Your word, Father, is truth, and it is to help us, to guide us, correct the areas that need correction, instruct us in the way that we ought to be living, so that we don't deal with untrust and break our faith. I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would bring that holy conviction and remind us of how much God's grace and God's love is for us, so that we can walk uprightly in the image of God. I pray that should there be anyone here dealing with thoughts of divorce, God hates it. If there's anyone that has ever used that term, I declare it be removed from their vocabulary, for they are dealing treacherously with the Lord. I declare, Lord, that if there should be any adulterers physically or spiritually in this church, Lord, you are cleaning us up. You're bringing us to the throne, and you're saying, lay it here, and I'll wash you clean, so that the bridegroom would receive you without spot and without wrinkle. Father, we fear you, and we pray for our loved ones. We pray for our spouse. We pray for them and believe. You joined us, Lord. You keep us, Lord. In the name of the Lord. And everyone said amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I know tonight wasn't a shouting night, but I'm okay with that, Lewis. More is caught than taught. Many caught a spirit of righteousness. Amen. Let's prepare for our best seed. Amen. This night, let's prepare right now for an offering of love unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise team is coming. What a blessing, and what a blessing. We give the Lord our best seed. Every chance we have a moment to sow a seed of faith, we do it because we know that we are giving unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. For many of you, you come in already prepared with your offering envelope. There's some behind your chairs should you need one right now, or just however you'd like to surrender your gift. Just, I want you to ask the Lord, Lord, what is my best seed tonight? And that's what I want to sow. Many of you will sow your tithe tonight. That's a tenth of your earnings. Hallelujah. Father, we give you, Father, our tithe. We give you our offering as it blesses your house. And it brings and rebukes the devourer in the name of Jesus. Blessed is the seed, and it's harvest time. So when you come up, think harvest. Amen. God bless you as you sow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And here hallelujah. I stand with arms wide open to the one, the Son, the everlasting God. The everlasting God. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the world, the Son, the everlasting God. The everlasting God. So I shout out
time, and let's all together stretch our hands and declare this seed as we have sowed and surrendered it to the work of the Lord. We know that fertile ground this is, and it produces the harvest that is now and even yet to come. And Lord, you said you bless a cheerful, hilarious giver. And Lord, we don't come burdened to give. We come gracious to live in the blessing of giving to your son Jesus our best seed. I bless the tithe. I bless the offering as we sow it to you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said amen. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. Well, let me just end, Lewis, with some words of love. I know Tiffany's doing very well. She is being transferred to University Hospital, and she's just getting better. Amen. So every time you think of Tiffany and Lloyd, little baby Evan, just think they're getting better. They're getting stronger every day. So Mama Kim's over there helping, and just everything's going great. I did want to make the announcement about our schedule for this month, July. We're very excited about what God is going to do this month. It's family month, and we have two nights designated for young people, and it's July 15th and July 29th. And the Lord has guided us in some different directions this summer, and we're just trusting in the Lord. And so it's going to be a great, great, great time of family. Everyone's welcome to be with us on those days, the 15th and the 29th. The special day I want to make mention also to all of us is the 20th of this month. That is a Wednesday night, the 20th of this month. That's just in a couple of weeks from now. We will not be having service here at Living Faith Family Worship Church on Grace Acres. We are taking our service. If you'd love to go with us, you're welcome to go with us. If you want to travel along and caravan, you're welcome and take people with you. But we're taking our church on a road trip. Amen. And we're going to Katy, Texas to minister under the ministry of Pastors Tommy and Rachel Birchfield there in Katy. So it's exciting. It's a 4-hour trip, but we're going to stop in Bucky's in 2 hours and get some beef jerky and some Gatorade and then drive the other 2 hours. And so we're doing our very best to get our shuttle bus prepared. If not, somehow we'll work it out. I've seen vehicles that have had 14 people in it that only have 3 seat belts, you know. No, it'll all be worked out. Amen. And so for next Wednesday, we're going to have a sign-up sheet. If you'd like to go, maybe you want to drive, or maybe you just want to stay back and pray. Hey, there's no pressure, but I just want to invite everyone. I was asked to minister, and I'm excited about this ministry trip. And I told my pastor, I said, you know, if I go, I take my family. He said, bring them all. I said, all right. Thank you, Jesus. So I'm excited for this road trip, and it's going to be great on the 20th of July. So mark your calendars. And it'll be great. Amen. Here, grab the hand of the person next to you. Father, we commit this day to you as we have worshiped you and given you honor. We bless you, Lord, and bless the remaining of our week as we dedicate it to you. I prophesy bonuses and increases. I prophesy promotions in the name of Jesus. I prophesy vacation time with paid time. Hallelujah. I prophesy the goodness of God among our families in the name of Jesus. And everyone said amen and amen. Shake someone's hand. God bless you. And we will see you Sunday.
So I shout out your name from the rooftops. I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hand, and I am yours. I am yours. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one. I'm sorry.
Every step that I take, every move that I